I think it's great. As many of you know, I have two positions. Of course, I work here at the Ethical Society, and I'm very happy to be one of the three leaders here, including Ann Clayson, who's back there in the back, the other leader, and Joe Schumann. So nice to have you here, Ann, as well. But in my day job, I am the deputy director of an environmental organization that was founded by the EPA, the National Park Service. And I'm deputy director of Groundwork USA, working with the EPA, the National Park Service, and a variety of organizations trying to figure out how can we restore this country. And our solution, of course, was not to just go off and do the work, but to work with a community. That we cannot solve the major environmental problems in this country simply by having a government coming in and doing some jobs and then leaving, but instead asking the neighbors, what do you want with this space? What's important to you? And how can we engage you such that when we leave this, this is your place. This is now your park, your garden, your community garden, whatever it is that you want to do. So I get asked a lot in my work, and as I travel around the United States to do this, and conventions in Washington, D.C., well, so is this going to work? Is this program going to work? And so I was always searching for a way, a means or mechanism by which we could really ground these lofty ideals into something that really mattered. I don't want to just hold on to some lofty ideal that for the good of the nation you should do this. I want some real science behind this. So I was here at the Society one day and wandered over to that gigantic big box store on the corner that sells books. And I came across this book right here, which we have in the back of the room at the end of this, A Localist Movements in a Global Economy by Professor David Hess. As I joked with Professor Hess, it was simultaneously the most uplifting and downgrading book I've ever read. And it was uplifting because I thought someone had almost opened the doors to another way of looking at our economy. Another way of understanding how we need to restore America, and it made sense. But it was also somewhat depressing because he's not just an idealist, he's a realist. This is a man who is honestly trying to figure out how to make this work, working with organizations. He understands all the challenges, and it's nice to hear someone who just doesn't reduce economics to just a few pat phrases. It's lovely, in fact. To have someone act like an adult and say, well, there are challenges here. It's not just free market, free market, free market. So I want to introduce to you Professor David Hess. He is Professor of Science and Technology Studies and Director of the Program in Ecological Economics, Values, and Policies at Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute. He is the author of another book. This is actually part of a three-part series. The first one called Alternative Pathways in Science and Industry. He's done lots of numerous articles. You can see him all over the internet. He's obviously spoken around the United States at a lot of conferences. And he's writing another book that will follow this one. So I called up to the university and thought, is it possible you would come for our pittance? And he said, I'd be happy to. So I'd like to call up, I think hopefully one of the most interesting speakers we've had in a while, Dr. David.
It's an honor to speak for this group with the history that this organization has had in American progressive politics. It's really fabulous what the legacy is of this organization. And did we just lose a signal on it?
Yeah, it's 1 second.
Okay.
Let me move this where I can actually get out of your way.
Oh, okay.
And their way, more important.
So if you open this morning's New York Times, the book review section, there are two books mentioned on, I think, pages 8 and 9. The first one, the title is Hot, and the next one is about the Arctic. And they're both pretty depressing books. They talk about, first of all, the first book talks about what we need to do by 2020 to avoid the worst catastrophe. catastrophes that are likely to befall our children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren. And the other looks at what's already happening in the Arctic, which is a pretty ugly scene. The reindeer meat is all contaminated. There's a lot of drilling for oil and natural gas going on up there. And it's a pretty sad scene. So I'm going to begin with the problem. This is not new to you. I know I'm preaching to the choir here. My father, who was a minister for a long time, actually said he didn't like preaching to the choir because they just came to church to sing. But he knew if he got the choir, if they liked the sermon, then he did all right. He said the congregation was easy. So I guess I'm really preaching to the congregation in a way. But let's go on to the first slide. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the problem. You're all aware of this, but just to sort of get you into the mindset so you understand a little bit about how I'm thinking about this. So let's look at the next one. This is a great slide from the Union of Concerned Scientists that shows the climate of New York State projected, both under higher and lower emission scenarios. So even if we do well, which we're not doing, Albany, where I live, is going to look like Blacksburg, Virginia, or Richmond, Virginia, which is where my parents lived after they retired. And it's a pretty different climate there. And if we don't do well, it's going to look more like South Carolina. Now, I just got up this morning and we had a terrible ice storm last night in the Albany area. The ice was just all over the branches. So, you know, having a climate like South Carolina may not seem that bad right now, but we all know that this has really serious implications. So let's go on to the next one. This is when all of the sea melts, all of the land ice melts and the sea level rises, it'll be a 100 meter rise. Now this is not likely to occur in this century. It's quite a long time off if it occurs at all. But it just gives a visual image of what this country will look like, and I suspect that this building will be underwater too. All right, next slide. And this is a updated version of the limits to growth model that was published back in the early 70s that Charles Hall, who's an ecological economist at Syracuse, has put in some dates. And he has argued that these collapse points are coming fairly soon, in the next 10 to 20 years. So this was a scenario about collapse, worked out way back in the 70s, and his argument is that we're just right on track to follow the baseline do-nothing scenario. Okay. Then on top of this, I pulled this out of an article, letter to the editor of the New York Times a couple years ago by an engineer who talked about what it was like when he graduated from college in 1969, what his starting salary was, and then compared it to some of the expenses and starting salaries today. I put these in, these were actual prices. So he bought a used car for $200, and then he found that an equivalent used car, when he wrote the article, would be $11,000. You can see here how several big ticket items have gone way up in prices and have not kept track with salaries in this country. So this is another piece of the problem. We'll go on to the next slide. And as a result, household debt has increased, and the national debt has increased. So we have both an ongoing slow meltdown of our economic system and of our environmental system. So, you know, looking at this, the way I look at it is we've got a basic problem, which is a concentration of wealth and a dysfunctional democracy that has led to two big failures to respond to our environmental crisis and our economic crisis, however you define it. So we're looking at the problem behind the problem. Next slide. And the vision I have, which I assume is a vision that many of you share, is we need public ownership. I am a democratic socialist. I have been since I started working for Dennis Kucinich back in the 1970s. And he's remained fairly true to his ideals. So I at least credit him for that. And then other kinds of reforms that are listed there on the slide. And, you know, this is, I think, what needs to be done just to get us to the point where we can actually enact these policies and make a change. So turning to localism, which is what I want to talk about next, I see this as a pressure point in the system. It's not the solution, but it's one place where we can sort of find a way of, almost like judo, taking the forces of the system and kind of turning it against it. And it's not the only place. And I think many of you have your own causes that you're involved in, and that's great. So it's just, you know, what we need to do is understand each other's causes and try to see how they connect. That's sort of my view about this. All right? Next slide. So in this book that I've written, I take localism to mean that the goal is achieving more local, independent ownership in the economy, to have small businesses, local nonprofit organizations, and that kind of thing. Now, that goal does not necessarily overlap with sustainability and social justice issues. And I've experienced a lot of that, which I'll talk about in the afternoon, as a co-founder of an organization associated with local living economies. Let me talk about that for a minute. So across the country, there's a network of organizations building local living economies associated with BALI, the Business Alliance for Local Living Economies. And up there on the slide, you see its vision, which is, I think, a vision of a kind of progressive green politics that is connected to the small business sector, which traditionally, back in the progressive era, was quite progressive, and then it became very conservative after the New Deal era. Okay, next slide. So I'm going to walk through some of the aspects of localism. One of them is this whole issue of fair trade, which you all, I'm sure, understand. Buying from locally owned, privately held cooperatives that make bananas and chocolate and that kind of thing. But also buying from locally owned and privately held independent retailers. So connecting this idea of fair trade with fair bought and resisting a little bit the way that fair trade has become part of Walmart and the chains and looking at what that means. So there's a little bit of a criticism here of where fair trade has gone, but also looking at some possibilities of how fair trade and fair bought can be connected. So looking at the retail sector, one of the themes is reframing what an independent business is. They're not shopkeepers. Prices actually are not always higher than they are in the chains. There's a great book called The Big Box Swindle by Stacy Mitchell that is really worth reading. But they're community stewards. They're third space. They're places where people gather. They offer better service and quality. An example here that's kind of become one of the poster children of this movement is Zingerman's Deli in Ann Arbor, Michigan, which has spun off its own businesses. It's a local gathering place. And, you know, it's an image of a small business that can really be an anchor of community life. And food cooperatives are a great example of this, too. Next slide. The mandala diagram here in localist thinking is this one, which is this idea that when you spend money at the locally owned independent businesses, more of that money recirculates in your community. And that's because they pay higher taxes, they give more to the nonprofit organizations, they buy more from local services, and they retain profits. So there are a bunch of reasons why this occurs. Okay, I'm going to move on. I'm going relatively quickly through this, give you a quick overview, and we can delve into this in the afternoon section. The reuse sector is one of those places, go ahead, where I see a connection between the localist, bi-local ideas and then the sustainability and justice. And these are some pictures that I took, and you can film these if you'd like, of the reuse center in Portland, Oregon. And what I love about this is the aesthetic of it. It's actually built from reused materials. Now, you probably wouldn't want your apartment or your house to look like that, but it's a great statement of what it is to reuse materials. Go ahead. And this is what it's like. It's like a big Home Depot, basically. It's all reused at much lower prices than any big box store could obtain. Go ahead. And they also do some, these are the windows as you can see them from the inside. They also do furniture remanufacturing. Next slide. Here's another place, Recycle North. And we have a bunch of case studies on my website, if you are interested. interest in reading about these in detail. Recycle North is a nonprofit reuse store in Burlington, Vermont. It sells all sorts of reused items, but also, next slide, does services where it works with at-risk youth and does training, giving them job skills. So putting together the social justice dimension, the sustainability, and the local ownership, all bringing it together. Next slide. And skills such as electronics refurbishing, but many other things. Okay, we'll go on to the next one. The food area is a big area, and I know Kurt can talk a lot about this. And there are some criticisms here about the feel-good foodies, the middle-class shoppers at community gardens, or I'm sorry, at farmers markets. And I do some of that. Let's go on to the next one. But farmers markets do a lot of good things, even though there is this limitation on them. And they can be located in low-income neighborhoods. They can bring fresh food to a wide variety of people. I'll go on to the next slide. But also great interest here are the community gardens. And that's what we focused on. So we did case studies of some 20 or so community gardens. And also looked at how they're getting connected with schools and they're doing education with this. So children are learning math, for example, by counting the number of peas in a row and multiplying and that kind of thing. So there are wonderful connections can be built here. And community gardens, there's a great history of them in New York that I'm sure many of you have been involved in, are not just sites for growing food. They're sites for incubating politics, community relationships, social networks, and that kind of thing. And actually, that may be the more interesting side of community gardens. All right, next slide. So I'll say a few more things about some other areas. Energy is a great area. There are some publicly owned municipal utilities. Seattle City Light is an example of this. These tend to be, they are among the greenest of the utilities, Austin, Sacramento, Seattle. They've done wonderful things. These profits are retained by the city government and it allows them to offer low-income programs. So they're not only green utilities, but they're equitable utilities. So it's a great model. And this is just some statistics on the public power and what they've done in terms of green power. Next. And in some cases, this has been blocked. San Francisco tried to get public ownership of its power and was blocked by outspent by the utility. And community choice is another area that you can get into that accomplishes some of the same goals. And I can talk about that in the afternoon. So there are a lot of different mechanisms here, and I want to just sort of take this idea of localism and push it out to all these different sectors and all these different movements that are going on around the idea of local ownership that connect with sustainability and justice issues. Next slide is transportation. So go ahead. The greening of transportation. There's a few slides here of the electric bus in Chattanooga, which was connected with revitalization. They do battery charge outs here. Go ahead to the next slide. And media, community media, which I'm sure many of you know about. Our media have been just incredibly concentrated, and this is due to policy changes. It's not just a natural evolution, but it's policy guidance out of Washington. And then there are our alternatives. My favorite in Troy, the Sanctuary for Independent Media, which is a great little organization that does wonderful things for the community and also does the local indie media website. Next. And then finally, I'm going to end with finance because this is a really important piece that I think needs to be addressed. So we'll go on here. Move Your Money. This is a campaign launched by Arianna Huffington and colleagues about a year ago. And the idea here is to move at least some of your money out of the big banks, if you haven't done this already, into community finance. And it can be credit unions, community banks, all of these institutions I've located here. It doesn't have to be everything. If you need that Bank of America account, and I do have some of my money in a large bank account, just because it's easier for international and other travel issues. You don't have to be a purist about this. That's the nice thing about it, is you can shift a little bit at a time. Go ahead. But we've got to really look at our 401ks. This is the area that we need bright financial people to break down the barriers so that you're not buying locally at that independent fair trade community organization with your left hand, and then your right hand, which has your retirement funds, is funding Starbucks and, you know, Walmart and all of this. So you've got to kind of try to get these things connected. And it's very hard because of the regulatory structure. A lot of people are working on this. Okay, go ahead. So this is sort of the problem here, is we have the right hand and the left hand not always working together. All right? And so we need to look at some higher risk, higher return options in the financial world. And for those of you who are investors, I would welcome an opportunity to talk about this afternoon. So I'm ending here with this issue of personal and policy, and I think this is very important. There's a lot you can do or I can do in our everyday lives, buying locally, looking at fair made, fair bought, looking at used goods, green energy, green transit, being the media, moving some of your money into community capital. Those are all things that you can do, and you can do incrementally. So it's really a great opportunity. And that's one of the powerful things about this movement, is it gives you something you can do. But that's not enough. I think you also need to look at the policy side, both at the local government side, and I list several types of policies there, and at the national reform side. And I know many of you have been involved in policy reform issues, so again, I'm preaching to the converted here, but really, I think we need to make sure that this doesn't just become a kind of neoliberal personal spending issue, but it's really connected to political reform movements that have been the history of this organization for over 100 years. It should be. All right, thank you very much.